Hey guys, Tyler here, and today we are looking at a foundational level quantitative comparison problem. So go ahead, pause your video, try this one out on your own, and then we'll take a look at the solution. All right, welcome back. So, as mentioned, this is a quantitative comparison problem. So what exactly does that mean? Well, we are trying to compare quantity A and quantity B and find what the relationship is. So in any quantitative comparison problem, these four answer choices will always be the same. So choice A means that quantity A is bigger. Choice B means that quantity B is bigger. Choice C means the two quantities are equal. And choice D means that pretty much more than one of the above is possible. There's not a consistent relationship there. For this problem in particular, I think one of the biggest mistakes I see is someone might head to this quadratic and try and just like plug in values for X to see if they can get something that works there. But we don't want to try and guess so much here. We want to be precise if we can. And what that comes down to is recognizing this is a quadratic. Basically, all that means is when you see a square on a variable, you're looking at a quadratic. And the generic form is that ax squared plus bx plus c equals zero. Now, part of that that's really important is this equals zero part, because there's something called the zero product property I want to mention here. So if I have something like a times b, and that is equal to zero, that tells me some important things. Either A is equal to zero or B is equal to zero, right? If I'm multiplying together multiple things and the end result is zero, one of those things themselves has to be zero. So what I want to try and do with a quadratic is take it from this form where everything is being summed together and try and rewrite it as a product that is equal to zero. And then I can apply the zero product property. So how do I do that? Well, the way to do that is through something called factoring. You might have heard of foiling before. Factoring is basically foiling in reverse. And the way it works is I want to look at this C term here, negative 15. I want to find two magic numbers that give me a product of negative 15. And then I want to look at the B term, negative 2. And I want those two magic numbers to give me a sum of negative 2. From here, it's always easiest to start with the product, because there's going to be infinite integers that sum to negative 2, but there's only going to be a handful that multiply to negative 15. And as you get better at this, you might be able to do this step mentally, but if you're first starting out or if you're dealing with a really tricky number, I think the easiest thing is to draw a factor table. So my goal is negative 15, and I'm just going to start with 1 and think of the different factor pairs that multiply to that. So 1 and negative 15, that'll work. I could also do the opposite, negative 1 and positive 15. And then I'm just going to increment my left-hand side. Does 2 work? Nah, 2 won't cleanly divide 15, so let me try 3. Does 3 work? Yeah, I can get 3 and negative 5, or the opposite. Let me increment again. 4 won't work. And then when I try 5, notice at that point, I've overlapped my left column with the right column. When that happens, I've found every pair that is possible. So now I gotta look at my pairs and see which one gives me a sum of negative 2. So 1 plus negative 15, that's gonna be negative 14. That's gonna give me a sum of positive 14. 3 plus negative 5, aha! That is the one I'm looking for that gives me my sum of negative 2. So to rewrite this, I draw out my parentheses. It's equal to zero. I'm gonna have an X there and an X there. Now I just insert those magic numbers. So X plus 3 and X minus 5. From here, remember what the zero product property tells us, right? Either that or that must be zero to get a product of zero. So my two potential cases are either X plus 3 equals zero or X minus 5 equals zero. And if I solve those out, I can see either X is negative 3 or X is positive 5. So looking at quantity A over here, again, that's 3 -3 or +5, when I compare that to quantity B, it's either going to be the case that B is bigger or A is bigger. So I've got more than one possible relationship. So my answer has to be D. It cannot be determined from the information given. Subscribe for more GRE Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep and leave us a comment telling us how you solve this problem. Happy studying.